we were going to have to pray, and I didn't put my hearing aids in.
Relips.
Isaiah 53. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed.
sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what He's done. I praise God for what He's done.
We are going to worship our way through the final hours of the life of Christ. Look at what He did in the upper room. Sorry, everybody. Don't know why that's happening. If anybody wants to help me out, I'm ready to be helped. We are going to just worship our way through the final hours of Jesus' life. I'm going to start with the scene in the upper room, and I would suggest that periodically, as I read these, that you close your eyes and you visualize what is happening to Jesus, to the people around. These are dramatic passages, and it's a dramatic scene, and so if you feel led to, close your eyes and just envision what's happening. We begin with the upper room. Then came the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the time when they killed the Passover lamb. Jesus sent two of His disciples, saying, "Go and prepare Passover for us." They said to Him, "Where do you want us to eat Passover?" And He said, "Go into the city, and a certain man will meet you carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house he enters, and say to the master of that house, 'The teacher says, my time is at hand. Where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large and furnished upper room. Make it ready for us." So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them. Now they're in the upper room, and as they were eating, Jesus took the cup and gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves, for I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And He took bread, and He gave thanks and broke it. He gave it to His disciples and said, "Take this, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in memory of me." Likewise, He also took the cup after supper, and when He had given thanks, He gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you." What an invitation. What a beautiful invitation. "Drink from it, all of you," He said. "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Truly I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom." A promise, an amazing promise. Well, we invite you right now to come up as you feel led to take communion, but with a twist. And the twist is that we have at the communion tables three nails, and we just invite you to grasp hold of the nails as you take the bread and as you consume the juice, and just remember His death in this graphic way by holding on to these nails. You come as you feel led to the communion table.
Hear the voice of love that's called. There's a chair that waits for you, and a friend who understands everything you're going through. You keep standing at a distance, the shadows of your shame. There's a light of hope that's shining. Won't you come and take your place? And bring it all to the table. It's nothing he ain't seen before. For all your sin, all your sorrow and your sadness, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. He can see the weight you carry and the fears that hold your heart. But through the cross you've been forgiven. You're accepted as you are. So bring it all to the table. It's nothing he ain't seen before. For all your trials, all your worries and your burdens, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. Nothing he ain't seen before. For all your sin, all your sorrow and your sadness, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. For all your sin, all your sorrows and your sadness, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. The question was raised as my conscience fell, a silly little lie. It didn't mean much, but it lingers still in the corners of my mind. Still you call me to walk on the edge of this world, to spread my dreams and fly. But the future's so far, my heart is so frail, I think I'd rather stay inside. But you love me anyway. It's like nothing in life that I've ever known. Yes, you love me anyway. Oh, how you love me, how you love me. It took more than my strength to simply be still, to seek but never find all the reasons we change, the reasons I doubt, and why do loved ones have to die? But you love me anyway. It's like nothing in life I've ever known. Yes, you love me anyway. Oh, I am the thorn in your crown, but you love me anyway. I am the sweat from your brow, but you love me anyway. I am the nail in your wrist, but you love me. I am Judas's kiss, but you love me anyway. See, now I am the man who yelled out from the crowd for your blood to be spilled on this earth-shaking crown. Yes, then I turned away with a smile on my face, with this sin in my heart, tried to bury your grace. And then alone in the night, I still called out for you, so ashamed of my life. But you love me anyway. Oh, yes, you love me anyway. It's like nothing in life I've ever known. Yes, you love me anyway. Oh, Lord, how you love me, how you love me.
Well, at this point, the disciples walk down the stairs of the upper room into the city. It's night. They're walking through city streets that have all the night noises of the city. They exit the gate to the city of Jerusalem and go down the Kidron Valley. Crossing the brook, they ascend the other side up to the Garden of Gethsemane. And that name literally means the Garden of the Oil Press. And just as olives are squeezed and the oil comes out, Jesus is going to be squeezed and pressed as he anticipates what's going to happen the next day. John 18, verse 1, when Jesus had spoken these words, he went out of the city walls with his disciples, and they crossed the Kidron Brook. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane, and there was a garden. And he and his disciples entered the garden. So he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go and pray over there." Jesus took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, James and John. And Jesus began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. Then he said to them, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch with me and pray that you don't enter into temptation." He went a little farther, withdrawing from them about a stone's throw away. And he knelt down on the ground, and he fell on his face, and he prayed, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. If this is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." What an amazing thing that he cries out, "Abba, Father," modeling to us that we can have that same level of intimacy with the Father as well. Then an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Don't you love it that the Son of God is strengthened? I mean, even he is strengthened by an angel so that he prays even more earnestly. Then Jesus' sweat became like great drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose up from prayer and came to his disciples, they were sleeping from sorrow. So Jesus said to Peter, "Simon, are you sleeping? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. I know your spirit is willing, but your body is weak." Again, a second time, Jesus went away and prayed, "Oh, my Father, if this cup cannot pass away from me unless I drink it, your will be done." He came back to his disciples and found them sleeping again, and they did not know how to answer him. So Jesus left a third time to pray, and he said the same words. But when he came back to his disciples, he said again, "Are you still sleeping? Behold, the hour is at hand. The Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners. Let's go. My betrayer is at hand."
Is my beginning. The line drawn in the sand. The end of all my striving. Now I am born again. There Jesus was forsaken. So I will never be. His grace is my salvation, the gift of God, the work of Calvary. It is done, it is finished. Christ has won, he is risen. Grace is here, love has triumphed over death forever. The cross needs no addition, his mercy is complete. His love is not in question. The Son of God has spoken over me. It is done. It is finished. Christ has won. He is risen. Grace is here. Love has triumphed.
Final and forever, it will not be.
Oh, it is done. It is finished. Christ has won. He is risen. Grace is here. Love has triumphed over death. Forever it is done. It is finished. Mercy won. We're forgiven. Sing his name. He is worthy of our praise, Jesus.
Well, now we come to scene three. And as we come to scene three, it is the next day. And he's about to journey to the cross and crucifixion. And one of the things it's important for us to know is that there were six trials overnight. Six. And every one of those trials was illegal. After the trials, he is whipped and he's beaten. He's mocked and he's spit upon. And now it's time for him to walk to the Via Dolorosa, which is the way of tears, to the place where he is going to be crucified. And if you were there, you would have seen people lining up this route. Some were mocking him, some were crying because they loved him, others were curious. But it's so like the world, you know, where people have different opinions of Jesus, and now they're going to see the Son of God in action, demonstrating exactly who he is. And when they mocked him, they took the purple robe off him, put his own clothes on him, and led him away to be crucified. And he went out bearing his cross. And when they had come to a place called the Place of the Skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha, they gave him sour wine mixed with gall to drink. But when he had tasted it, he would not drink it. And then they crucified him. As they were doing this, Jesus said, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." Now, it was the third hour, and the soldiers took his garments and divided them up. Now, the tunic was seamless, woven from the top in one piece. Therefore, they said, "Let's not tear it, but let's gamble for it. Let's cast lots for it." So they divided his garments among them that the scripture might be fulfilled. They divided by garments, and for my clothing, they cast lots. You may recognize this comes from Psalm 22, verse 18. In Psalm 22, there are 12 prophecies about the Messiah that are fulfilled on the cross and in the resurrection, three days later. This is the ninth prophecy. Think about that. Nine prophecies get fulfilled while Jesus is on the cross, from Psalm 22 by itself. Now, Pilate wrote a title, and he affixed it to the cross. And the title said, "This is Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." The title was written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. But the chief priest said to Pilate, "Don't write the King of the Jews, but write, 'He said I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "No. What I have written, I have written." Two robbers were crucified with him, one on his right and the other on his left, with Jesus in the center. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, "He was numbered among the transgressors." Two criminals on either side. Numbered among the transgressors comes from Isaiah 53, verse 12. And this is a wonderful picture of Jesus identifying with us, those who are destined for an eternity that is tragic, and Jesus is numbered among us. And those who were passing by down below were blaspheming him. They wagged their heads, saying, "If you're the Son of God, come down from the cross." Likewise, the chief priests also mocked him, saying, "He saved others, but he can't save himself. If he is the King of Israel, let him come down from the cross that we may see and believe. Then one of the criminals also blasphemed Jesus and said, "Hey, if you're the Christ, save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him, saying, "Look, do you not even fear God, seeing that you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we're here justly, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said to Jesus, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." Now from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, the sun was darkened, and a black darkness spread over the land. Just for a moment, just imagine that you're there, and the weather pattern begins to change, and it becomes dark like midnight. It becomes dark like a fog descends over the land. Everybody stayed. Luke tells us that. Everybody stays, and they encounter this inky black darkness. And it must have been an awe-inspiring, fear-inspiring sight. They sense something supernatural is taking place in that moment. 3 hours. And then about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which is translated, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Some of those who stood there said, "This man's calling for Elijah." And Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, said, "I thirst." You know, when you're in pain, it's very disheartening for people to misunderstand you. And everybody was misunderstanding Jesus at the absolute most painful moment of his life. Now, a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there. One of the bystanders ran and took a sponge. Filling it with sour wine, they put it on a hyssop reed and they raised it up to his mouth and offered him a drink. Jesus said, "It is finished." Then he cried out with a loud voice and said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And having said this, he bowed his head and he breathed his last and he yielded up his spirit.
Your goodness, I would be desperate without your love, slave to the darkness if it wasn't for the cross. You have won me with your kindness. Chase me down when I was lost. Where would I be if it wasn't for the cross? And hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. I was a prisoner, now I'm not. 'Cause with your blood you bought my freedom. Hallelujah for the cross. All my shame with mercy, now your mercy will be my song, and all the glory bought my freedom. Hallelujah for the cross. And by your stripes I'm healed, and by your death I live. The power of sin is overcome. It is finished, it is done. By your stripes I'm healed, and by your death I live. The power of sin is overcome. It is finished, it is done. By your stripes I'm healed, and by your death I live. The power of sin is overcome. It is finished, it is done. By your stripes I'm healed, and by your death I live. The power of sin is overcome. It is finished, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was a prisoner, now I'm not. 'Cause with your blood you bought my freedom. Hallelujah for the cross. 'Cause with your blood you bought my freedom. Hallelujah. Waking up to a new sunrise, looking back on the other side, I can see now with open eyes, darkest water and deepest pain. Wouldn't trade it for anything, 'cause my brokenness brought me to you, and these wounds are a story of you. So I'm thankful for the skies, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart, and I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for the sky. Now I'm standing in confidence, with the strength of your faithfulness. And I'm not who I was before. No, I don't have to fear anymore. I'm thankful for the skies, 'cause without them I wouldn't know. And I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for the sky. I can see how you delivered me. In your hands, in your feet, I found my victory. I can see how you delivered me. In your hands, in your feet, I found my victory. I'm thankful for your scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And with my life I'll tell of who you are. So forever I'm thankful for
So forever I am thankful for the sky.
Well, now we come to the final scene, and it's a very, very short scene, but it bears a little bit of explanation. The Gospel of Mark starts with these words, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. In the middle of Mark, Peter declares that Jesus is the Christ. And at the end of Mark, the centurion declares he's the Son of God. So the tension of the beginning of the Gospel of Mark is realized at the end by a centurion. And here's what happens. And when the centurion who stood facing him saw the way Jesus died, he said, truly this man was the Son of God. An amazing admission. How did he know that? He knew it by watching the character of how Jesus died. What he said on the cross, how he treated the criminal, the whole thing. This guy had seen probably hundreds and hundreds of crucifixions. He was hardened to all of the pain and the shame of that event. And yet this time it was different because of the way Jesus died. He knew for sure who he was. And now is fulfilled Isaiah 53 verse 6. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. As we worship, I want to call the prayer team up, and we're going to worship, and if you have something that you need prayer for, you can come up while worship is taking place, and you can get prayer. And what a night to be able to receive prayer on this Good Friday evening.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, song shall ever be. We're only going to be here just a few more minutes. And it's not very often that you get to spend an hour contemplating the sacrifice of Christ for your life. And it's not very often that you have people who are prepared to pray for you, to lay hands on you, to encourage you, to mourn with you, to take that burden that Christ died for that you keep carrying this evening. It's the beauty of the cross that it's already been paid for. It's the beauty of the cross and the sacrifice of Jesus that it's already been covered by his blood. So I encourage you before we leave tonight, if you have something that's heavy on your mind or heavy on your heart, to take the opportunity just to pray. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and I wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean, sing it how marvelous. Shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Sing it, how marvelous, how wonderful in my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Father, we thank you for the gift of your only Son. We thank you for the redemption of our sin by his blood. God, we worship you this evening in the remembrance of what Jesus did and what it means to us. And we await with the rest of creation the resurrection. And we look forward to celebrating you. We thank you for this time. We thank you for your presence that is so sweet. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As you're dismissed this night, our prayer partners are going to just hang around for a minute. If you didn't want to come up front in front of everybody, you can still come and be prayed for. But we'll see you Sunday morning at 8 or 9:30 or 11. Have a good evening.
I'm in all of you. I'm in.
is a place where sin and shame are powerless. Where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness. Where all